Jesus Christ has broken. Well, good morning. Welcome to TVC. My name is Brian Moat. I'm on staff here, one of the worship leaders. And I just want to welcome you guys here this morning, especially if this is your first time here, maybe your first time visiting, and maybe your first time in church. Maybe you grew up in church, but it's been a while since you've come, and we welcome you. We understand that church can be a little bit weird sometimes, and you might not understand everything, but my prayer is that God still moves in all of our hearts and all of our lives this morning. Amen? And we're going to sing a song, and you may have heard it on the radio. We played it right before this song that we just did, and it's called Is He Worthy? And it's kind of a cool song, kind of like a responsive reading sort of thing. But there's some words in there, some phrases in there that might seem a little bit weird if you're not familiar with the Bible. But in Revelation, it talks about a scroll and seals. So in the song, it talks about this. And what it really represents is just God saying, who is worthy to open this scroll? Jesus is. Jesus is worthy. And in Revelation 5, it says this, then I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll with writing on both sides and sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming in a loud voice, who is worthy to break the seals and open the scroll? But no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth could open the scroll or even look inside it. I wept and wept because no one was found who was worthy to open the scroll or look inside. Then one of the elders said to me, do not weep. See, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has triumphed. He is able to open the scroll and its seven seals. Jesus, he can open the scroll because he is God, because he took our judgment. He took our sin on the cross, for he is worthy. So we're going to sing this song. And you'll see on the screen, it'll say leader and all. And where it's yellow, you guys sing in response to what I'm singing. It's really easy. You guys will catch on. But let's stand together. And Father, we come before you this morning. We know that you are worthy. We know that you deserve our praise. And now we give it with all of our heart, God. We give you all the praise, all the glory. We love you. Do you feel the world is broken? You say, we do. Do you feel the shadows deepen? We do. Do you know that all the dark won't stop life from getting through? Say, we do. Do you wish that you could see it all made new? I said, we do. Is all creation groaning? It is. Lord, is a new creation coming? It is.
Come on. gets out of way. Like a hurricane, you are moving. And you are speaking, Lord. Holy Spirit, move. Move in our hearts this morning. Move in our hearts, oh Lord. For you and you alone are worthy. You are worthy. You open the scroll. Took our sin, Lord. Our mess and made us whole. Oh, how we love you.
Sing this.
We exalt thee. We exalt thee. We exalt thee. Oh. We exalt thee, we exalt thee, we exalt thee. Oh,
one time, let's sing it from our hearts.
We exalt. Exalt thee, Lord. You and you alone are worthy, God.
Lord, you are so, so good. And Lord, you are worthy of all of our praise. And even when we do not deserve the love that you give us, Jesus, your grace covers us, and we thank you for that.
I will sing for your glory, shout out your praises. Every day I live, every day I live, till the world hears your story. Shout out your glory, every day I live, every day I live for you.
It's
Good morning, everybody. It's good to see you. How many of you got wet coming in? Would you just, all right, just get over it, all right? This stuff happens occasionally. A little rain has to fall in every life and all that, blah, blah, blah. So that sounded profound, didn't it? Don't you think, right? Yeah, okay. So anyhow, welcome. Why don't you do this? If you're by somebody that you know fairly well, why don't you turn and look at them and say, I'm so glad you're here with me today, and then give them a hug. Come on, just do it. I want to say welcome to everybody. Glad that you're with us today. And if you happen to be here, if this is maybe your first, second, third time, something like that, special welcome to you. This is our prayer that when you leave, you will feel like it was worth the time invested, even with the rain and all the struggle and all that, that you'll leave and you'll say, I feel like it was worth the time that I put into it. That is our prayer. We'd love to have you fill out a connection card if you want to. I don't want you to feel pressure to do that, but you'll see them in the pocket, seat pocket in front of you. And if you fill that out, you take it out to the information center. They've got a gift for you, or you can hand it to, you know, put it in the offering or hand it to somebody who's got a name tag on. And we'd love to make a connection. Again, we won't spam you or anything, but we're glad that you're with us, and I hope you'll be encouraged. I want to just mention to the church family, because I thought this was cool, that last weekend, that we know of, 24 people made decisions for Christ. Is that cool or what? I'm just always amazed by that. Sometimes people come and say, you know, I went to a church for years. I don't know if anybody ever made one for Christ. And we see this on a regular basis. And I'm just so grateful. I love seeing people make decisions moving in God's direction. Of course, you know, you make a decision for Christ. It's not like I made the decision, that's done, I'm never doing anything. That's one step of many steps that you must take in your spiritual life to grow in your relationship with Christ. Another one that I think is really important is when you, so to speak, make it a public statement, and that's through the idea of baptism. Baptism, many of you know this, is where we identify with what Jesus Christ did for us through his death as we go down. Well, let me just clarify it. TVC, we're not sprinklers here. We're dunkers, all right? You go all the way under, and depending on how bad you've been, you may stay there for a while, all right? We just take you down, keep you there for a little bit. I'm just joking on that. Some of you are like, no, I'm not serious. But we identify with his death, his burial as we go down in the water, and then with his resurrection as we come up out of the water. Being baptized is more than just a symbol. It doesn't make us a follower of Christ. But something happens when we make the decision and say, I want to make a public statement. I'm all in for God. See, it's one thing when you're in a church service and you say, yeah, I want to follow Christ. I want to give my life to him. But when you make that statement public, when you say, I am all in for Christ, it takes you to the next level. And that's an important one. Now, we have baptism coming here, actually at all of our campuses at the end of the month. Did they already put up a sign on the screens? Yeah, it's like the 26th and 27th, so it's just a month away of October. And we'll do them at all the services here at this campus and our other campuses. And if you have not been baptized and you've made the decision to follow Christ, I'd love to, or whatever campus you're at, we'd love to be a part of your baptism. And here at, in Hastings, we do it right here in front in a horse trough. So it's nothing but the best for the people here out in Podunk Holler. And it's great. I think it's great. And it's a real celebration. And so we'd love to have you sign up and be a part of that. You know, sometimes people will say to me, I was baptized like as an infant in my family. So, you know, is it wrong because I kind of want to make this public statement? I always tell people, absolutely not. Because I think, from what I can see in Scripture anyhow, baptism is a statement that you make, not one that is made for you. And so I believe that there's nothing inappropriate about saying, yeah, I want to be baptized as a now a person who's made the decision myself. I want to tell the world I'm all in for Christ. So you can sign up, you can call the office, you can go out to the next step area, the information center. You just give your name to somebody with a name tag and tell them you want to be baptized, and we'll make the connection with you. You can also sign up online. Just go to our website, tvcweb.com/baptism, and you'll be there, and you can sign up for that. And we'd love to have you be a part of that. So, okay, enough about that. We're going to worship God now by giving our gifts of tithes and offerings. So, ushers, you can bring the baskets up if you'd like. And if you're visiting, don't feel any pressure to give. This is something we do as church family. I will say to the church family, to those of you who are faithfully and consistently giving, thank you, thank you, thank you for doing that. When people make decisions for Christ, it's not because we had such great music. We have good music. It's not because we have good preaching. It's just because we all work together to help people do what our mission is, connect with God. And so thank you for being a part of that, because that is a big part of that. We'll pray for the requests on the prayer wall over there, and then we'll go on with the service. So would you join me in prayer? God, we're so grateful, so thankful. We lift up those 24 people who made decisions to follow you last weekend, and maybe others that we don't even know about. And we pray that as their journey begins now, that they would continue to move in the direction of walking with you and growing with you, and their lives would be built in you. Lord, we lift up the people who have placed requests in the wall for whatever those requests are, brokenness in lives, in families, in relationships, sickness and despair and darkness. We pray you bring light and hope. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And we trust that you'll do that. And now, God, we, in faith, with thankful hearts, because you've blessed us, we bring our gifts and we give cheerfully in Jesus' name. Let's say together, amen.
I struggle to find any truth in these lies, and now my heart stumbles on things I don't know. My weakness I feel I must finally show.
Well, I want to say hey to everybody joining us online. Glad you're here with us. I'll let you in a little secret about me, all right? If I had my choice, I would never talk when I spoke publicly on anything controversial. I would never hit on subjects that would get people angry. And I know some of you are going, seriously, you make me angry almost every time you stand up there and speak. But I'm not doing it on purpose. You should know that, all right? There's no intent there. And if I had my choice, I would speak on topics consistently where people would go, I just feel so good after, you know, I'm done speaking, and that's what I would like to do. But if you're talking about what you believe is ultimate truth, it is inevitable that feelings are going to clash occasionally with that truth, that sometimes you're going to speak on things and people are going to be like, I don't agree with that. This is one of those weekends where that's going to happen, all right? This is not one of those times that I actually anticipate or look forward to when I talk about things that are perhaps controversial. And I know, and I want to clarify up front, that I may say some things in which you will say, I'm not sure I agree with that. I'm not sure that, you know, I buy into that at all. And I want you to know that I honor and respect your disagreement, your honesty. I actually do, and I hope you would afford me the same courtesy. But the fact is that being a pastor, if you're talking from Scripture, you're going to at times say things that people don't really want to hear. Would you agree with that? I mean, in fact, it's going to happen on a fairly regular basis. And so with that caveat, I want to start by asking kind of a sober question. I want to get you thinking, and I'll come back to this in a few moments, but I want to start by getting you thinking about this question, and I'm not looking for out loud answers in any way. If Adolf Hitler, when the end of World War II came, and most of you, I'm sure, know the story, that he was found, but he had committed suicide. But if he had been found alive, if Adolf Hitler had been found alive and captured, what should have happened to him? Now, this is a man whom led the way. He wasn't solely responsible, but in many regards, he was responsible for the extermination of 6 million Jewish people, like so much vermin, just exterminating them. He was part of and oversaw unbelievable deprivation, unbelievable pain, horrific suffering, and then he's caught. He's apprehended. I don't want you to talk with the person next to you. I just want you to think, what do you think should have happened to him? If we'd have caught him alive and we had him, what should we have done with him? Do you think he should have been executed? Do you think he should have maybe been tortured a little bit before he was executed so he could feel the pain and suffering, a sampling of what he inflicted on countless millions of people? Do you think he should have been just given a life sentence without the potential for parole? Should he have been given a slap on the wrist? What should have happened to Adolf Hitler if he'd have been caught alive? What do you think? And just let that simmer a little bit. See, we're now week two in a series that we started last weekend, as you saw, called The Good Stuff, and we're kind of going through the book of Romans, not from verse-by-verse perspective, but hitting some of the high spots, and we're talking about some things that were talked about in the book of Romans, and I invited you into, this is an 11-week series, and last weekend I invited you into something that I want to invite you into again this weekend. That is, if you're going to be around for this series, and I understand if you're not, but if you are, we would love to have you join us and read through the book of Romans. Not just hear somebody talk about some of the verses from it, but read through it. Now, we advocate for a Bible app. It's called the YouVersion Bible app. Doesn't matter what phone you have. You go to your app store and you'll be able to download. That's the icon that they use. And you download the YouVersion Bible app and you go in. And a lot of people I know are doing this. I've talked with a number of people who are in on this. But you go into their plans and you search for deeper into Scripture, Romans. You will find a reading plan. Now, this is a reading plan that goes through a 30-day period. There's 16 chapters in the book of Romans, so you're reading roughly the equivalent of a half chapter a week, a day. It's just not that much, really. You don't have to read that much. And here's what's cool about this when you do this, is that you actually can join with other people. So my wife Ann and I are doing this together. It's just really cool because, you know, whenever she does hers or whenever I do mine, you know, I'll read through it. And this particular reading plan tells you should read through it a second time, third time, even a fourth time. And obviously those things are optional. But then what's God speaking to you? And you share that. And it's just really cool to do that. So I invite you to consider, number one, doing that. And then number two, I would invite you to consider the idea of receiving a text a couple times a week with just Roman verses. If you want those and it's just through the series, you can just text the word Romans to 77948. If you do that, then you'll get those. It ends at the end of this 11-week series, and obviously, again, neither one of these tools do you need to use or must you, but these are things that we'd like to offer because I think they will help you as we go through this series, just kind of get a better grasp of the Scripture itself. So as I said, we're going through the book of Romans, where Paul, the author who penned these words, inspired by the Holy Spirit, starts out very strong. And of course, if you've read the New Testament, much of it is written by the Apostle Paul, and you know that he always talks strong. I mean, this was a guy that just had deep passion. But he starts out in Romans with pretty strong thoughts, and really, in effect, the idea that you can ignore the idea of God. You can reject outright the idea of God. You can say, well, I don't know if he is or is not there, so I'm just going to abstain. I'm just agnostic. I don't know. You can kind of just deny his existence. You can do it anyway. But he says, if you do that, you're missing the truth, and that is that there is a God. He is there, and there are clues for him everywhere you look. But see, God created you with a will, with the with the ability to choose. So you can just say, I choose to be busy in this stuff and my life is just overfull and I don't have time for God. You can choose that. But Paul says this, and it's kind of a warning, really, and it's strong. And most of us don't like to be talked to this way, but he says, in effect, you do this at your own peril. Because there is a God. This is his contention, what he believed and what countless Christians have believed now down through the last 2,000 years. And this is what he said. We saw this last week, but Romans chapter 1, verse 20, he said, since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, in other words, what you can't see with your eyes, his eternal power, his divine nature, they have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made. In other words, by what you can see, you see the clues of God. And then I underlined this part because I thought it was important. So that people are, say it out loud with me, without excuse. These are strong words. He says, you can reject God. You can ignore him. You can say, my life is too full, too busy. And it's okay because God made you with the ability to make that choice. But in effect, he says, you do so at your own peril because there is a God. See, the problem with rejecting the idea of God, or at the very least, simply ignoring the existence of God, the problem is that as individuals and really as an entire species, we go down a path that grows dark very quickly. Because if there is no God, and I want you to hear this now, if life is simply chance, if we're simply chemicals, and the DNA that comes handed down, you know, through the millions of years, through our ancestors that decided this was best or that was best, if that's all we are, then you have to understand what that means is that in the end, there can never be any claim to any kind of moral code. I mean, you might say that you hate what Hitler did, that you think it was wrong, but who gives you the right to say that? What makes what he did wrong or what someone else did right? Who decides what is right or wrong? If there is no God, there is no moral code. Professor Arthur Leff from Yale wrote an essay, and he talked about this, and I thought this was such a great quote, I thought I'd share it with you. This is what he says. He says, when would it be permissible to make the formal intellectual equivalent to what's known in bar rooms and schoolyards as the grand says who? And then he explains what he means by this question. He says, in the absence of God, each ethical and legal system will be differentiated by the answer it chooses to give just one key question. Who among us ought to be able to declare, quote, law that ought to be obeyed? Now, he said, stated that badly, the question is so intellectually unsettling, one would expect to find a noticeable number of legal and ethical thinkers trying not to come to grips with it. And then he says this, it's so powerful, he says, either God exists or he does not. But if he does not, nothing and no one else can take his place. In other words, if there is no God, there is no real legal claim to you being the authority on what is moral or what is not moral. It doesn't matter what you say. He's saying if there's no God, there's no way to say one action is better than the other, or different than the other. And this led him to end this particular essay, which with what I thought were really strong words. He says this, he says, as things are now, and folks, you know this is true because in our culture, let's just talk about our culture for a moment, the American culture. We have moved from being a declared Christian nation to a post-Christian nation, and now, in many regards, some of you at least, I think, would agree with me, that at times you almost feel like it's anti-Christian nation. There's a kind of a sense of a pushback against the whole idea of believing in God. So he says, as things are now, everything's up for grabs. Nevertheless, he says, napalming babies is bad, starving the poor is wicked, buying and selling each other is depraved. There is such a thing as evil, he says. In other words, we all know that. All together now, he says, tongue in cheek, says who? Says who? And then he ends it very ironically saying, God help us. And there's the irony. We don't believe there's a God. You know, we don't think there's a God. We're not paying attention to a God if he is there. But God help us, because when you live that kind of culture, when you live that kind of life without the awareness of God, without a connection with God, there is no moral authority. And this is what happens when you move to that place where you have no awareness. Or see, if God's taken out of the equation, we move into trouble very quickly, because both as individuals and as a people, what happens is that we now have no basis for right or wrong. And I know some of you are saying, well, we know the difference between right. We know what's right. Everybody knows what's right. Everybody knows what's wrong. Really? You really think that's true? Do you realize how long I could point out inconsistencies to that idea? That people say, well, everybody knows what's right. Do you know that today, in the enlightened realm of 2019, with all the wisdom that we've gained through the ages and all that we know, do you know that in one culture, for example, in the American culture, to beat up a woman is anathema? You don't do that. And we all believe that. We all agree with that. You don't beat up a woman because you're a man and you have more strength. It is wrong. But in other cultures in our world today, it is perfectly acceptable to beat the woman up if she gets a little bit out of line. Says who? Who says it's wrong? Who says it's right? People say, well, you know there's a right and wrong. Really? Because depending on the culture you come from and the background and your experience, you may view right and wrong as entirely opposite things. Come on, is that true? Okay, I feel like I'm talking to a mural out here, just all little drool coming down there, all right? Is that true? I mean, you think about it, it's absolutely true. And people say, well, no, intuitively, we know right from wrong. No, not really. And I'm not trying to vilify people who disagree with me or with what we think in our culture, but I think it's something that we need to be honest about. We need to process. And this is exactly what Paul talks about in Romans, especially in the first part, as he talks when he talks about people who reject God. Let's take a look at this. This is at the end of chapter 1. He says, furthermore, just as they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God or a connection with God, so then God gave them over to a depraved mind. In other words, he says, if that's what you want, go for it. You have the ability to choose. So, he says that they do what ought not to be done. They've become filled with every kind of wickedness and evil, greed and depravity. They're full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, and malice. They're gossips, slanderers, God-haters, insolent, arrogant, boastful. They invent ways of doing evil, and they disobey their parents. They've got no understanding, no fidelity, no love, no mercy. Although they know God's righteous decree that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these very things, but they also approve of those who practice them. This, he says, is what happens when you take God out of the picture. Is that you slide further and further to a place of deprivation. Now, it's not always in every life that way, every time, but this is exactly what happens on a larger scale. And here's the great irony in all this, is that though we fall into these kinds of activities and we do things that even those of us who say, I know what's right and I know what's wrong, we're always breaking what we believe is wrong rules. Come on, let's just be honest. We know stuff's wrong, but we're doing wrong stuff anyhow. We all do that. Here's the great irony. We don't necessarily believe there's a God, or we're just ignoring him and not thinking about any kind of moral code. And we break our own rules, what we believe is right, and we do what we believe is wrong. We do this on a regular basis, and yet in us, seemingly inexplicably, there is this sense that there is right and wrong. This is exactly what Left says. Still, napalming babies is wrong. Selling people into slavery is wrong. There is a sense that there is a right and wrong, and there is something in us that has a desire to see people who do what we believe is wrong punished. We believe there should be, on a larger scale, justice, or you could say ultimate justice. So it brings us sort of this place of massive confusion because we say there's a right and wrong, but it's based on what we believe, and we break our own rules, and it just makes for a confusing morality, even in the culture we live in today. You can see it all the time. Let me give you an example of this. And this is not in any way talking about political issues, but you have on the one hand people who these days, you hear this a lot, there are a lot of wonderful advocates for the treating of animals in an ethical and compassionate way. And I am with them on that. I am all for it. I believe that we should be treating animals in an ethical and compassionate way. I say yay. But they have a strong, passionate heart for that cause. And yet some, not all, but some of those same people can be very comfortable with the idea that it's perfectly legitimate to terminate and dismember a human life simply because it hasn't made it out of the womb yet. And again, as Left would say, says who? Now, I'm not talking really about where your stand is on you know, the right to life or abortion or any of that subject. I'm just saying, can you see the dichotomy that comes in our lives when we become our own moral code unto ourselves? Is that we hold one thing that can appear to be in a direct opposition to another, and yet we do that. This is what happens when you have no moral law or code in your life, because you have rejected the idea of a higher being of God. And this is exactly what happens. And this is what Paul's trying to drive home to the people in Rome, because they, like us, they had fallen into patterns of, you know, breaking their own rules, their own code of what they thought was right or wrong, like all people do, and then they point the finger at somebody else, but they're, you know, this is what we love to do. It's like, I sometimes when my wife's upset, I just want to say to her, well, you should be married too, and then I think of the worst person I can think of, you know, and this is what we love to do. And Paul says, be careful of that. Take a look at this. He says, those people who fall into these patterns, they're on a dark spiral downwards. This is, by the way, from the Message paraphrase. He says, but if you think that leaves you on the high ground where you can point your finger to others, think again. Because every time you criticize someone, you condemn yourself. It takes one to know one. Judgmental criticism, he says, of others is a well-known way of escaping detection in your own crimes and misdemeanors. But God isn't so easily diverted. He sees right through all such smoke screens, and he holds you to what? Yeah. What you've done. You didn't think, did you, that just by pointing your finger at others, you'd distract God from seeing all your misdoings and from coming down on you hard? Or did you think that because he's such a nice God, he'd let you off the hook? Better think this one through from the beginning. God is kind. I love this last statement. God is kind, but he's not soft. He's not soft. See, what we tend to do is we ignore God, and then we fall into patterns of destructive behavior and hurt, and then we compartmentalize, and we like to look at others who seem to be worse than us, and in effect, we become, at least in our minds, we become the great says who. It's what I say is wrong. It's what I say is right. Because when God's left out of the picture, there is no clear moral code. But Paul makes clear that you have to remember a single critical truth, and I talked about this last week at the start of this series. Here's a single critical truth that matters so much more than anything else. There is a God. There is a God. Let's just say it out loud together. There is a God. There is a God, and that changes everything. It changes everything. There is a way that is right. There is wrong. And you know innately already that there is a need for ultimate justice, because you believe there should be justice when you see somebody do wrong. You want there to be justice. There is a God, and there is ultimate justice. So Paul starts with this clarity. There is a God, and therefore, because there is a God, there is the need for, and actually there is, ultimate justice. The thing that you want for Hitler. You know, you thought about Hitler. My guess is that many of you said, well, probably he should have been executed, or he would have to be punished for his crimes. We use those words. They have to be punished for their crimes. We actually, innately, we believe that justice should be, there should be justice, because God's existence, the fact that there is a God, demands that there is justice. Paul goes on, and he continues to clarify in Romans chapter 2, verses 5 and 6. He says, you're not getting by with anything. Every refusal and avoidance of God adds fuel to the fire. Day's coming, he says, when it's going to blaze hot and high. God's fiery and righteous judgment. Make no mistake, he says, in the end, you get what's coming to you. There is a God. This is why Paul says, so we're without excuse. Because if you ignore him, there will come that day when you have to face the reality that there is a God. And because there is a God, his existence demands ultimate justice. This is both frightening and exciting. It's frightening if you're not a follower, if you're not connected to God. There is a God and there is justice. That is a frightening thought. But if you are a follower of God, if you're connected to him, you know that there is a God, and because of this God's amazing love and grace, which we'll talk about next week, there is ultimate justice. But there is freedom for us. So in case there's any confusion about what I've been saying, I want to just lay it out there, because sometimes I think people wonder about this. I will tell you, this is an interesting thing, because everybody believes in justice for other people. Come on, is that true? But they don't like the idea of what it means to them. They really don't. In fact, they've done surveys for ages on this thing. And the vast, vast majority who believe that there is an afterlife will tell you they believe there is a heaven. And the majority of those people will tell you they do not believe there is a hell. We like the idea of heaven. We do not like the idea of hell. See, even when I say that, I can feel that in here, like, dude, hell, don't talk about that. It's because we like the idea of heaven. We don't like the idea of ultimate justice if we're in the picture. But I want to make it clear, because we stand with the historic Christian church, that actually there will be ultimate reckoning and there is judgment. And we don't like that idea so much because it doesn't sound very loving, but the righteousness of God demands justice. And there is a central Christian truth around this, that there is a God, there is justice. You know, some of you know this. As a church, we try to keep everything very simple. We don't try to go, you know, get all weird into lots of different areas, and we stay pretty general. But our statement of faith, most churches have a statement of faith. TVC's statement of faith is simply to agree with what the historic Christian church has embraced for its predominantly its existence, and it's was put together and called the Apostles' Creed. Let me just read through it again, just so some of you who, many of you heard this, you quoted it in church when you were raised in. We believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son. In other words, we believe there is a God who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried, and he descended into hell, and then the third day he rose again from the dead, and he ascended into heaven, sits on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty, and from there he'll come to judge the living and the dead. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of the saints, the forgiveness of sins, yay, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Let's say it together. Amen. Amen. That means so be it. We believe these things, and there's so much good in here. We believe in forgiveness. Yay. Life everlasting. Yay. Jesus loves us. Yay. We believe all that stuff. But don't forget that in the middle of it, there are these words which are sometimes hard for people to take. He shall come to what? To judge the living and the dead. And as much as that may make us uncomfortable, this is what we believe as followers of Christ. Do we believe there is a judgment day? You bet we do. Because we understand that God's existence demands ultimate justice. And yet, if we're honest, there's a part of us that really doesn't want the idea of judgment. We don't want the idea of hell. Can I be honest with you? I don't want it. I certainly don't want it for myself, and I don't want it for people that I know and love. I wish it was not there. Can't we just all be happy? Can't we just all just let it go and let it go away and forget about everything? Can't that all happen? But see, critical thinkers will tell you that that kind of mindset is almost always the luxury of a protected and privileged lifestyle, which I've had. Do you know why I think those thoughts? Because if I would have had to watch one of my children or my wife be violated and then killed in front of me, I would want ultimate justice. Come on. And there are people all over the world who actually have very strong sense about the idea of ultimate justice, because there is a need for justice in the world. I love what author Scott Saul says about this. And again, this is just a quote from a book that he wrote. He said, when we call the Bible's teaching about judgment into question, he said, we not only put ourselves at risk, we also put all the victims of injustice, violence, oppression at risk. And we make the vulnerable people of the world even more vulnerable. We permit the bullies to continue bullying by insisting that God is a God only of love, not a God of judgment. He says, if all people go to heaven and there's no ultimate accounting for evil, what are we to say to the Jews about Hitler? It's a great question. What are we to say to the victims of abuse? What are we to say to little girls who have been sold into the sex trade by heartless bullies who care nothing for their personhood? If a judging God did not exist, then we would be living in a world of Darwinian chaos in which the strong eat the weak and only the powerful survive. I agree with this statement wholeheartedly. See, I may not want justice, at least in some ways, as it relates to myself or to people that I love or whatever, but I understand that because God exists, there is a God, there is justice. And it is part of God's plan. His righteousness demands this. And it would be so much easier for me to just kind of avoid this subject, but this is part of the Christian faith. We believe, number one, there is a God. Amen? But we also understand that because he is, there is ultimate justice. But what makes Christianity so magnificent, it is the monotheistic religion in the world that doesn't say, okay, well then to escape justice, because we're all broken, and we'll talk about this in the coming days, to escape that you just work hard. No, Christianity understands that you just simply cannot work hard enough to make that happen. But God, this amazing creator who is and who is just, so loved his creation, who turned their back on him and went crazy wild, that he was willing to pay the price for them. He paid the price that we owed. He served our sentence. And he offers us amazing grace. I don't know about you, but I'm so thankful for that, because I know what I deserve. I know the darkness that there is in me. I've seen it. And I know by default the same is in you and every one of us. And I know some of you these days, you're living with a lot of darkness around you. Things are just, feels like the walls are closing and it's so hard. Can I just say to you, really all I wanted to say this weekend is just, there is a God, there is justice. But he loves us. And the only thing that keeps us from that love is when we choose at our own peril to ignore his existence and to not be connected with him on a consistent basis. But because he loves us and because he's there, we turn in his direction, his arms are open. And you may not understand it all. I don't understand everything about God. He's way beyond me. But I will tell you what I've learned, and it may help you. I watched my kids when they were young. I think every one of them, before they got old and sophisticated. So this is when they were pretty young. But they would be upset about something. They would be confused. They would be hurt. They'd feel like maybe I'd shafted them in some way. I had, you know, and sometimes I had. Sometimes I was disciplining them in a way, and they didn't like it. They didn't, and they knew. They're crying, and they're all upset, and they know, you're partly responsible for this. But this is an amazing thing that they would do. Even though they felt that and knew that, they would fall into my arms. It was crazy. It'd be like, you're half mad at me and you're crying, and yet you're hugging me. Do you know why? Because children understand intuitively that there is protection and comfort in the arms of their father. They get that at an intuitive level. It's hardwired. And so I would hold them and bring them in. And there they would find that comfort, and there they would find that relief. Now, when they got older and more sophisticated and had to figure it all out for themselves, they were more distanced from me. No wonder Jesus said, if you want to inherit the kingdom, you must become like, does anybody know? Little children. Just open your heart. There is a God, and there is ultimate justice. But that God of ultimate justice loves us and is there for us. Amen? All right, let's stand to our feet. And we'll close with prayer. That wasn't too painful, was it? It was painful for me, but hopefully it wasn't too painful for you. So let's pray. God, now help us. Help us to take this strong awareness that you are and that you're just. And that there is justice, and that the only way that we are able to live forever with you without the consequences of our brokenness is by your amazing grace and love. So we're so grateful. We choose to walk out today with our heads up and our hearts redetermined to walk and connect with you. In Jesus' name, let's say together, amen, amen. Have a great day. Bless you. There'll be people in front who'd love to pray with you if you have a prayer need.